session. So I really, thank you all for joining us today. I'm really excited to introduce to you Linda Li, AKA Panda. She's the creator and designer, the founder of Panda Club NFT, which is on the Solana network. I first learned about Linda through one of the Facebook groups, Subtle Asian Investing, I believe, either that or crypto. And yeah, I was inspired by her passion for creating NFT to address the mental health, but also I also love one of her other collection, which is all about cultural heritage NFTs. And so Linda, are you able to unmute yourself? Do you want to
Yes. Hi. Yeah. Hello. Thank you, Ed, for having me.
I'll pass the screen to you and you can, feel free to start.
Sure. So hi, everyone. My name is Linda. For some reason, the poll keeps popping up in my face. So I am currently a New York-based artist. I'm at my boyfriend's place, so he's a filmmaker. There's a bunch of film stuff behind me. But I myself, I'm mostly a comic artist and also traditional watercolorist. So I'm the founder and CEO of Panda Cub Stories LLC, where I split my time between, drawing slice of life comics, and I'll talk about that a little bit, because the star of my comic series is basically the face of my next NFT collection. But I also teach Sichuan cooking online. So those are two of the legs of my business, and all of them kind of come back to kind of what I find really important in my life. One is reconnecting with my Chinese culture and background, and the other is living and thriving as someone who is neurodivergent. So when I met Ed, part of what we talked about was the mental health aspect of my work. So go ahead and share my screen because it'll be a little bit easier to explain. One moment. All right. So if you can see a bunch of pandas, this is my website. And the project that Ed actually found me through was the 100 Chinese character painting project, which was kind of the starting point of my artistic career. So a bit of background, I went to Duke for undergrad, and then I was at Cambridge for my master's, where I studied children's literature. So when I was at Cambridge, what I really focused on was, All right. Can you see the screen that says 100 character paintings? I'm a little unfamiliar with Zoom.
Yeah.
Okay, great. So this is my first NFT collection, which I'm releasing slowly. So not all of the pieces are available, but all the pieces that are available have already been collected. And these paintings were kind of my first attempt to use art as a way to both address and then also celebrate my own neurodivergent brain. So I was diagnosed with ADHD when I was an adult. So growing up, I really struggled with a lot of things that required kind of memory retention, and tasks that seemed repetitive or boring to me. So I was put in Chinese school by my parents, and they had high hopes. And, I was very gung-ho at first when I was a kid, but no matter how many times I, tried to copy and memorize the characters, they just couldn't stick in my mind. So actually when I was at Cambridge, I was studying kind of how picture books help children who, were learning English really imbue meaning with the words that they were learning to read through pictures. And I had this idea to do the same with Chinese characters. And so that ended in 100 different watercolor paintings that I did during my year at grad school. I worked with another child to kind of design it. And these 100 characters, each of these became one of my Genesis collections. So it's called the 100 Character Project. And so when I started minting these, because I had already moved on stylistically a little bit from the watercolors I started with to the more kind of like manga and anime inspired panda cubs, these were the ways that I combined those two. So basically, like, where I started my mental health NFT journey is when I was brought into the space, and I am very new to crypto. So I'm actually like, okay. I'm feeling okay, because I, as someone growing up in an Asian family, like especially, I am quite bausho, or quite not timid, but like I never want to spend more than I can afford to lose, right? So like I invested a little bit in Solana, which is where my NFTs are hosted. But basically any of the investments I've made have all come from the proceeds of my NFT sales that I've already made. So I'm looking at the market sometimes, but lately it's been going down, so I just haven't been checking it that much. And for me, because my introduction to crypto was very much through NFTs, that is where most of my attention is. And so for my 100 characters collection, I'm donating 30% of annual sales in dollar amount to different mental health organizations. So this past year, I donated to the National Alliance for Mental Illness. And kind of my modus operandi as a creator is I'm situated a little bit in between one-on-one individual artwork and I guess the profile picture projects that we are a little bit more familiar with, because the main character of my comic series, Panda Cub Stories, happens to be a cute little panda cub. And so what I strive to do as an artist is create content that, you know, adds to my reader's life or my audience's life in some way. So that could either mean teaching them a language that I am learning myself, so Chinese. I write and illustrate a lot about my own mental health journey. So sometimes like those are the pieces that most resonate with my readers as well. And I really find it important to talk openly about mental health and the struggles that we face, because I think like the worst thing that can happen is if we're worrying and we're scared and we think we're in it alone, right? And so kind of shining a spotlight on that using my art is very important to me. So the next collection that I am launching is these 888 drawings of different panda cubs, but each of those are uniquely crafted based on either like a story or a situation or just like some element that has inspired me or inspired one of my audience members if they've submitted something as an idea. So, yeah, like I guess I won't ramble on too much, but I am at the very beginning of my NFT journey, and kind of what I have been finding is that, both like in the crypto space as well as NFT space, right? Like there is a lot of, I've been learning new terms like FOMO, right? Fear of missing out, or I guess like people who are selling right now and in panic, right? Like the fear of losing something and then that having a negative impact on you. And so what I have been finding is that even in the NFT space, which I find overall incredibly positive, like everyone is very welcome, or at least like I'm mostly like in the Solana NFT space, everyone's very welcoming, they're kind, they're very helpful, they're very, you know, like wag me. But at the same time, like so many of us are just like super sleep deprived, or we're on Twitter all the time, or we're on Discord all the time, because like, you know, either we are as a collector afraid that we're going to miss the next drop and, you know, like happiness or whatnot is going to run away from us if we're not, you know, like on all the time. Or as a creator, it's really easy to play the comparison game as well, right? Like seeing another artist, like, you know, selling their piece for 300 Solana, right? Whereas like when I started, like my pieces were selling for like 0.8 Sol, which I was already really happy about as a new time creator. But like when you're seeing all of these different like numbers coming at you, it's sometimes hard to lose or to keep grounded and to really like know why it is that you're creating, or if you're a collector, like why is it that you're collecting? And so what I strive to do both as a creator in my own process of making art, as well as kind of what tangible benefit my pieces can bring to both my collectors as well as like the world in general, like I really want to focus on the idea of both creative and wellness longevity, right? Because I think there are a lot of people who can do really well, but still be incredibly stressed because they feel like they need to, you know, like if they, you know, loosen their grip or take a breath, like they're afraid that things are going to pass them by. And I really believe that, you know, the NFT space, the crypto space is as otherworldly as it seems sometime, like it's still very much a part of our universe. And so what I want to bring to the space as a creator is someone who takes more of the slow and steady route. And yeah, like I create art because I love it. And I've gotten some promising like response, right, from collectors who also love my art for the art. And kind of like, sometimes in a space where things seem very transactional, my kind of goal and how I have been selling my pieces is each transaction is quite personal. So I love creating little gifts for my collectors. Everyone who owns one of my character painting NFTs will actually be receiving one of my Panda Cub Guardian NFTs when those launch. So they're kind of like waiting for those. So when they launch, we're going to do like sort of a gamified version of it where not everyone will get the panda that comes with their character painting, but they'll kind of like be randomly mixed and dropped into different wallets. And I have like this whole idea going forward because kind of the pandas will be starring both in my comics, and eventually I plan to write and illustrate picture books. So they will also kind of be, you know, like popping from my mind into the blockchain, into different wallets, and then back into the like narrative. And who knows where we will go from there. So I will end my spiel with actually showing the, I guess, roadmap kind of for my actual Panda Cup collection. So if people are interested in following along, I'm currently kind of collecting contact information of people who are interested when the project launches. So right now you can't actually purchase one, but to give a little bit of background of what these are, they are basically love letters and also kind of physical historical markers of where I am at my life and my creative process. So the plan is to generate a collection of 888, and these will both be kind of my Genesis collection in the style of digital art, but it will also be my only PFP collection. So instead of going the algorithmic generative route, which was actually what I had first planned, it was what was recommended to me by the person who brought me into the space, I will actually be drawing each of these by hand. And the idea is that each piece that comes out will be a love letter to one of these stories or images or artists who have really made a positive impact, I believe, on my life and on the artistic and broader community as a whole. And each of these will be dropped with the exception of the 100 that are reserved for my character painting holders via auction. And so I plan to release these in the spring of 2022. And I'm very excited. I've already worked on a lot of the initial art and I can't wait to see where this goes. And for me, it's like, no matter where the market is at, it will not kind of change how excited I am about this project. And I'm just really grateful to have been introduced to the space, for Ed to bring me on. I love meeting new people. And I would love to just connect with all of you. I am very derpy and active on Twitter, so come say hi. I'm at Panda Cove Stories. And I'll pass the mic back to Ed. I will stop sharing my screen.
All right. Thanks for sharing about your journey, Linda. I know that a lot of people, who have been, whether they have been in the space or they're not in the NFT space, and they, like, it's always great to see like NFTs that are created by hand, but also the NFTs that are created like with a purpose behind it. Because I've been in the NFT space for about almost a year, right? I haven't been in it for that long, but I've been in it for a year, but I've seen a lot of the NFTs that are just made for the sake of like making NFTs. Like you'll see these people who will just copy, like they'll copy like a Bored Apes thing. They'll put like a monkey, a different type of monkey, or they do like a duck, and then they'll make like 10,000 of them and then put them online, right? And you go on the forums and all the Discord or the Telegram, you ask, hey, what are these for? Are they any utility? And they'll actually just kick you out because you're asking the hard questions. And I've been in this race and I'm just getting tired of like all these like NFTs without purpose, like NFTs that are just churn out for the purpose of milking people. I'm tired of that, and it's good to see Linda that you're making art with like purpose behind it. I mean, like whether this is to express your cultural heritage or just the idea of just sharing sharing about like a different you notice how you had like Pokemon stuff, right? Just sharing like some of the stuff that you're passionate about, and I'm sure that some people also like whoever Pokemon, right? And just so it's pretty cool to see that you have something like that. And the best part is you're on a journey where you want to show the world that that even though you have like a ADHD, you're able to like generate and express yourself in a way that people can enjoy. So that's pretty cool. Let me see if we have any like questions from the audience. I know someone was asking about some of the terms out there, like floor and such. So maybe I can explain a bit about it. Let me pull up your collection.
I can share my screen again if that is helpful.
Something is asking about floor, so maybe I can explain them what they are.
I think that might have been when I had this collection up. So here we have like floor, and this is my exchange art. So go ahead.
So just to explain, you're new to NFT, right? Floor is basically like the price of the cheapest NFT within this collection. So you can see that Linda's collection, like people love it so much that if you want to buy the cheapest one, you have to pay 8 SOL for that, which is around $800 right now. So And then a volume means how many, how much in terms of Solana has been transacted so far. And then right now you have 21 created. And so these are just some terminologies. For those of you who are new to NFT space, you will learn eventually. Sometimes when you go to like, let me look up another one.
Yeah, so real quick, Ed. So right now for volume, this is specifically only to exchange art. So actually most of my NFTs were purchased on the primary market on the Olaplex platform. So those sales aren't reflected here. So like the volume 3 Sol are pieces that have been listed on secondary, which is what this collection is, and have been sold. And so the interesting thing for exchange art is you can also make an offer to pieces that have not been listed by their owners. So if you wanted to, you connect your wallet and offer something. But right now, this character, Zhi Sun, is the only one that has been listed for sale. I think the last sale was for the character Nian. So that was listed and then sold about 14 days ago by someone.
Yeah, and then also in terms of the price, right? Right now it says floor is 8, right? It's 8 Solano. It varies depending on which network you're on, because right now Solano isn't the only network that exchanges that NFTs. If you're on Ethereum network, right, you can go on OpenSea to buy and view different NFTs, and then this is something to note. It varies on each different network, and I guess at the end of the day, it comes down to which network you believe in, right? Or you feel that suits your needs. I know a lot of people, they use Polygon because it's very cheap to transact, right? And also to mint on Polygon. I also know some people they are very strict about sticking on Ethereum because they feel that Ethereum it was the first NFT platform they want to be like. They want to hang out with the OGs, original artists. But the downside to that is every time they mint, they're paying about $50, $100 just to mint. And then you also have newer markets that are popping up, NFT markets that are popping up on Harmony, which is a one, right? And then you also have NFTs that are popping on Phantom, Avalanche, even Terra, Luna Terra. So that's pretty. So there are a lot of art, art markets out there. And at the end of the day, it comes down to for collectors out there, it comes down to where you hang out, the crowd you hang out with, and the network you believe in. And just know that not all networks are the same. Some network will grow faster than others, depending on the team behind it and depending on the utility, right? Because NFT isn't just the only thing, right, on these chains. So this is important to know. And if I can ask you questions I know you mentioned that you were on Solano. Maybe if you want to share about why of all the chains out there, why Solano?
Sure, yeah. And did you hear that OpenSea is they announced today that they're going to be adding Solana NFTs. So they're working with Phantom, the Phantom wallet, to do an integration. So that's pretty cool. So I basically chose Solana as a blockchain. One, because the person who brought me into the crypto NFT space, he and his partner are building a project on Solana. Their project is called Lit Jesus. And it's a very interesting project. It's kind of a mix between algorithmically generated art and fine art. So my friend who's the artist is actually an acrylic painter. So those pieces are very interesting, visually to look at. So he was very much a Solana maxi or a Solana champion. But I actually ended up sticking with Solana because I had, done a bit of research. And I think probably as an artist, arguably starting on the Ethereum platform, might have been to my advantage, because like there are a lot more collectors on there, right? And then OpenSea is one of the, or is the biggest NFT market. And as of right now, the only NFTs that they host are ones that are built on ETH, although that is changing. So that is exciting news for me. But I chose Solana also because of the low gas fees and the fact that it is more eco-friendly. So for those of you who, well, I don't know what like the crypto knowledge is in this room. For me, it was absolutely zero. Like if it could be a negative number, it would have been a negative number. Like I'm very like deer in the headlights when it comes to technology. So I didn't even know what a blockchain was when I first started. And when I first started researching NFTs, I actually like my first reaction was like, I'm not going to do this because like, you know, there's so much bad press out there, like in the beginning. And then a lot of my friends were like, it's terrible for the environment. You know, like, don't you know that Bitcoin, you know, annually uses the same amount of electricity as, I don't know, like Sweden or something. And I was like, oh my gosh, am I like killing the planet? Like, that's not what I want to do. But when I dug a little bit deeper, I had seen that different blockchains, basically function in different ways. And so Solana uses something called proof of history instead of proof of work. And I can get into that later on a very basic level. But basically that means that they use a fraction of the energy that more established chains like blockchain and Ethereum use. So like Ed mentioned, if you want to mint something on Ethereum, like put something on OpenSea, I actually minted one thing and it cost me like $297 at the time just to mint it and list. And yeah, and so it's like if my collector wanted to purchase one of my NFTs, depending on the gas fee at that time, it could be anywhere from $50 to like over $200. And that, first of all, like is not very affordable if you're a new collector, but like the reason why the gas fees are so high is because the amount of energy necessary for that transaction is also very high. Whereas for Solana, like each transaction on the Solana blockchain uses about the same amount of energy as like two Google searches. So while it's not, you know, green in the sense that every time we use electricity now, it's not necessarily green, it's not necessarily like more damaging, right, than any other activity that we already do. So at the end of the day, that is why I chose Solana as a platform. And I stayed because I am really loving the community of like specifically one-on-one artists who are creating artworks on Solana. And the collectors I've met on Solana have been very generous and also just like, you know, like not everyone is doxxed, but some people like chose to dox immediately. And even the ones who haven't like, you know, put their real identity online, like I've communicated with them enough to really get like a warm sense of like, oh, this is the type of person that I would want to possess one of my artworks that I think like, yeah, like will kind of be in this big ripple effect of positivity, but mindful positivity, right? Not just like, blind positivity, which is not always good. So that's my reason for choosing Solana.
That's pretty cool. Yeah. Yeah. Are you okay if I ask, if I have some, maybe like, let's just say, I do have a question. Someone just direct DM me a question. It looks like a bit of a tougher question, but are you okay with that?
Go ahead.
So, yeah. So this person, I think he could be a Bitcoin maxi, and he's asking about what's so special about NFTs? Can you just right click save? Like, why should they buy from you?
Sure. So yeah, I think it honestly, like two answers, right? So, and of course, like I'm by no means an expert on NFTs. This is just what I understand myself as someone who is primarily an artist. So an NFT is a way for me to share my art with a broader audience, but also as a collector. So like, since I started selling NFTs, I've made a couple of purchases, some PFP projects, profile picture projects, and some like more unique pieces of art. And so, yeah, it's absolutely true, right? That you could right click and save any sort of digital image online. And so I think like at the end of the day, it's like, what are you looking for when you make any sort of purchase, right? That is tied right now, I guess, like to an aesthetic output. Although like I've heard that, you know, like NFTs and smart contracts can be used in a lot of different ways. So maybe like real estate in the future, like instead of going through like this whole big process of buying a home, like it could, you know, I don't know, be a single click transaction. I don't actually know how like that's going to work, but I think like it would be useful to look at the, I guess like two big buckets of NFTs right now that people are purchasing. And one is like these, you know, big like 10,000K projects, like Gary V's V Friends or Bored 8 Yacht Club, or I think CryptoPunk was like the very first one, where like people sort of like bought into, not necessarily I would argue for the actual artwork, but more because it's almost like you're it's almost like you're investing into a stock, is how it was explained to me. So like each of these NFTs are essentially like tokens, right? So it's like, you know, sure, like I could go online and take a screenshot of somebody else's stock portfolio and be like, oh, look, I have like this. But at the end of the day, like it's not, like, you don't actually have the thing, right? And so I think like when you think of NFTs as something that is like of monetary value and can be traded, right? Like there are a lot of people who flip NFTs out there. You know, like right clicking and saving, you can have the image, but you won't be able to like sell the image to someone else for a profit. So I feel like that's a very utility based explanation. But yeah, like the other, I guess like category of NFTs where I think like I fall in myself and a lot of like more traditional artists, right? Say like oil painters or watercolorists or people who do like very beautiful single pieces of digital art. So it's like, you know, what is the difference between someone paying money to buy the NFT file of your work, whereas like some random, like, you know, like Bob in his basement in Utah can also right click and save and, you know, have the exact same image on his phone or his computer. And so I would kind of explain it in two ways. And so one is as a small creator, I have had, you know, like before I got into the crypto space, I have patrons. Patreon is a platform where people who are your fans, right, can give you money for some sort of return. So, you know, for me, they pay me money and every month I publish like a Chinese like reader comic that they get. And so like technically, right, if they wanted to, they could post that online. And I publish all of that content free online as well through my Instagram. And so like they could technically access the exact same thing for free, but because they believe in me and they believe in me as an artist, and also because Patreon like packages it more neatly, like they are happy to spend the money because I give them something of, I guess, like emotional value. But I think like from, if you're buying art, right, like because you both believe in it and also because you want to make money out of it, I would actually say that the traditional like established fine art market works exactly the same way as like when you're purchasing an NFT artwork, right? So it's like, what is the difference between, you know, a Picasso that you purchased from Sotheby's auction for, I don't know, let's say $8 million versus, you know, some really talented art student did a exact copy of the same painting, right? And so like, it would be almost impossible to tell the difference. Like you could have that as well, right? And so that's like a physical right click and save, or let's see, like 3D printing gets to a point where you can just like print a really famous piece of artwork. Like that's still not that piece of artwork, because art as a product is just really weird, right? It's like we imbue it with value as a society beyond what the original creator has created. So it's like, and so for traditional artwork, it's like you have this whole ecosystem that provides provenance, right? So it's like, if all the experts agree that this is the original painting, then yes, if I hold the original, like I have all of the value, and it doesn't matter how many, you know, perfect replicas are out there, like, because I am able to prove that it's the original, then I have bragging rights, or I can sell it at auction next year for, I don't know, like 10 million, right? And so for like an NFT artwork, it's the exact same thing, except instead of it being a physical product, it's a digital asset. But because, like, you know, all the fancy schmancy blockchain stuff, like it can actually prove like which of the original files actually came from like the artist's wallet, and it can track each transaction to say, like, to actually say, right, like who actually has the original. So yeah. And I, like, I can talk about this all day. I have all these opinions about the art market as it is. And there are people who are like, the fine art market right now is just for money laundering, right? It's like rich people like buy it too, blah, 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 blah. And so like, wherever you stand on that, it's like, it's, yeah. Like for me, I think like that's the closest comparison I can make. But of course you can right click and save if you just want, right, a screensaver.
Yeah, I mean, like, I'm just adding on to that, I'm like, and also to elaborate a bit more, right, I'm like, the nice thing about the blockchain is that you have an online, like, record, right? It is on the blockchain, it is online, like, and it will show, like, and through the blockchain, you can tell, like, who was the first minter, right, of maybe a collection. You can see, like, you can actually trace back, like, the original artist's collection, so that anybody who does like a right click save and they try to mint it on, like, they'll see the timestamp that, oh, this timestamp, this copycat was minted like a month after the original collection, right? And that's how you you can verify, like, who's real or not. And some of you may be aware that Twitter, right, they are starting to support the NFTs, right, where people who own NFTs can make the NFT as a profile picture, and Twitter will actually go through a process where they actually check your wallet. So you have to connect your wallet, right, to Twitter, and Twitter will look at this NFT token, and it'll see like whether this token is from like the, whether this token is part of the original collection, and whether this collection is certified, where there's a blue check mark, right? And if it fits the category, Twitter will allow you to make it as a profile picture. So there are ways where you have different platforms that they are allowing people to have a sense of comfort to know that whoever's showing this has a real deal. And also in addition, there are the nice thing about NFTs is more than just a picture. There are games that are being built out of NFTs, and I'm pretty sure Linda has plans to make a game in the future. So, and if you want to play the game, you need to have the real, like, panda cup, right? You can't just have like a right click copy of the panda that you wouldn't be able to get in the game. So there are some benefits, pros and cons for having stuff. We are going to be wrapping up very soon. So I just want to see if you guys have any other questions before we wrap up and maybe open up the floor for happy hour and open discussion. I know that it's getting close to like 11 p.m. Where Linda is at. So